Thank you, thank you. Welcome here. Thank you all for having me. First, I would like to tell you that I'm going to share my slides with you afterwards. So if you want to make photographs, it's okay, but I will share the slides with you. I'm a little bit nervous, and when I'm nervous, I can talk really fast. So if I'm going too fast, please tell me, then I will try to slow down a little bit. Today I want to share a lot of tips, well, 10 tips, on how to make your editor love you and Embraco. And as said, we won the award for best editing experience with one of our platforms. And I gathered 10 tips to share with you today. But first, my name is Fedorsia. It's a difficult Russian name. I'm a digital marketer at Perplex. And Perplex is a Dutch agency. And we build platforms and a website for all kinds of clients. And my background is in communications and design. And I've been working with at Perplex for almost 8 years now. And we work with Embraco for almost 10 years now. And with my background in communication and design, I really like to make the CMS that we build for our clients even more user-friendly than Embraco already is. And the part of making it extra user-friendly is not only in design, but it's also in making sure the editor knows what he's doing and making sure that he doesn't have to think about the CMS. Like I said, last year we won the award for best editing experience, and we won it with our platform for Dirk Zwager. It's a lawyer platform, and it's one of the biggest law firms in the Netherlands. And this law firm, there work almost 150 specialists, and they blog about their knowledge every day. So over the years, they gathered a lot of articles online. And with this platform, we make sure that they can publish over 1,000 articles each year. And they publish them themselves. And the main focus of Dirk Zwager is share their knowledge online. So with this platform, we make sure that all the authors, authors can create the articles themselves, publish them themselves. And we try to make it very simple for them, not only for these editors, but also for the visitors of this platform. Because at this platform, they try to find all the knowledge that they need for the questions that they have. But we also had the challenge to make sure that these authors write good articles and attractive articles, and that they keep them up to date. So we made a quite unique Embraco installation, and I would like to show you something, some of the parts that we did for them. First, you see the personalized environment for each author. And what we did was build a dashboard where they can see if there are articles in drafts, how many articles they've published, but also how many articles are ready for review. Because we really want to stimulate them to make sure that all the articles are up to date. Even when something changes in the law, that they can find the articles that they need to review. We also made sure that they can see some important statistics on their dashboard. And they're all based on their own articles. So they can see how many page visits there are, they can see how many conversion points there are, but also average time on page. And I will tell you a little bit more about the conversion points later. They can also see how their articles are doing compared to other articles and other authors. And we made a top five for both items, and they are based on the conversion points. Here you see an article page, and at this page there are quite some actions that we thought were very important conversions. So we built a formula that gathers all the actions that are really that the visitors went through on the page. And with this formula, we build some sort of scoring. And with this rate, we can check if the article is very successful. And when the article is successful, the author is successful. And when you see the detail of this page, you see some of the conversions that we thought were very important. For example, it's the sending an email to the author, share his article, visit the detail page, or a newsletter registration. And all these items have their own points, amount of points. And with these amount of points, we gather a score. And when we see this statistics dashboard, every author can see all these statistics for his own articles. So here he sees the page visits, the conversion rate, but also the average time on page. And we also show them these conversion points, not only total, but also per article. And when you look at this dashboard, here you can also see the specific conversion points that were reached. So the author also knows what kind of conversions went through for the visitors. But that's not all what we did. We also tried to build Embraco in a way that it helps the authors to write relevant and better articles. And here you see the document type for an article. And we used some sort of, a couple of our tips. And one tip is here, also use the labels and descriptions. And we also try to make a logical tab structure where you can see that content and settings is separated. You can also see that the rich text editor has a visual, I think we call it a quote, yeah. You see the visual quote, and it's really how it's shown on the page in the front end. So the editor, we help the editor to see how the page is going to look like. And when you see the tab with settings, here we try to help the author to think about what he's going to write, but also what tagging should be attached to the article. And here you see a list of topics that are blurred, but the topics are related to the discipline that the author has. So we give a lot of suggestions for topics that could be related to this article. And we also help the author to think about the audience that he's writing for. So we determined a lot of personas, and with these personas, they score the article. So when we know what type of person the visitor is on the platform, we show them the articles that are related to their persona. So that was Dirkswager, and this is the platform that we won the award with. Some of the tips are in Dirkswager, but there are a lot of more tips. And I would like to get started with the 10 tips and share them with you. But first, we're doing this for the editor, and the editor is a person. And in this case, the person is James. I call him James. And James uses Embraco. He's fine with it. I think we can tell by the look on his face. And let's make it our goal today to make him a happy camper. And let's start with tip one. Tip one is a login screen. Here you see the default login screen. I think we all know this one. A very quick and very easy tip is to personalize this screen by using a photo. If you work for an agency, you can add a photo of your agency and make sure that the people on the in the image are the people that your client works with. So this is very recognizable for the author, for the editor, and also for the agency. You can also add a photo of your client. And in this case, we did it for Hospital Isola. And here at the image, you see their building, but you also see their logo. So all the editors know for sure that they are in the right environment. Very easy tip. That was tip one. Let's continue to tip two, the start screen. And the start screen is the first screen you see when you log into Embraco. And at the start screen, there's some information about Embraco, about community. And I think it looks fine, but we can wonder if this is what the editor needs when he's working with Embraco and working with his website and trying to add content and build more wonderful pages. So why shouldn't we personalize the start screen by adding, in this case, an example of Perplex, adding an own image and adding our own contact information, and make sure that the editor, when he's in desperate need of help, he can contact us any minute and he knows where to find us. What we also did was adding training, our training portfolio. We tried to help the editor with creating content, creating images, and by this portfolio, we can show them how to help them. But you could also show here your news item or any other related items that could help your editor when he's working with Embraco. We can also make it a functional start screen by adding the mostly used actions for this editor. In this case, we added three buttons where they can add very easily add an article, and they can add a news item, and they can add a user, and make sure that they have one less click needed to perform these actions. When your editor isn't alone, and he's working in a big group of editors, and they work in Embraco at the same time, why shouldn't we make this start screen more of an editor timeline, where we can show what is happening in the CMS, who's working on what page at what time, showing pages that are ready for review, but you can also show pages that are waiting for approval. And by making these adjustments, you make it a real editor timeline dashboard. And last but not least, you can also combine these and make it a functional and personalized start screen by also adding information from external systems like Google Analytics. And this is what we did for Dirk Trager. We make sure that the editors don't have to go to Google Analytics to show the statistics. We added them to Embraco because that's where they will be. Let's go on to the next tip. Tip three, icons and colors. Default, this is what Embraco looks like when you only want to add some icons, but you're not putting in a lot of effort in it, and you're picking just one item, one icon that you like, and you use it for every document type that you build. If we really want to help the editor, we should pick a specific icon per doc type. And we have to make sure that it's an icon that really shows and tells what the page is about. That makes it easier for the editor to scan and to see what page he needs to adjust or needs to manage. But we can also extend it with colors. And what we can do is, in this example, you see that there are specialists. There are the orange overview page on top. And you also see the folders where the items that are managed in the overview page of the specialist are gathered under beheer, under manage. And we also make them orange. And this makes some sort of visual mapping based on the colors and on the icons. And when you're trying to create a clear overview of the icons and the colors, please don't forget to add the descriptions. This is very useful for editors who won't get a training. Maybe by launching the platform, you train the editors. And later on, there are more editors that are joining the team. With these icons, colors, and descriptions, you can make sure that every editor knows what doc type he needs to use for the type of page that he wants to create. So this was James. A couple of tips ago. And I think we got his attention, but I don't think it's enough. And there are some tips left, so let's continue to tip four. This is the rich text editor toolbar. And by default, or by adding all the possible options, it can be very overwhelming. And we can ask ourselves the question if it's really necessary to add all these items in this toolbar. Because if we take a look at these items, you can ask yourself, when does the editor need these items? Like alignment to the right, is it something that the editor should do, or is it something that the designer should do? But also add special characters. I'm not sure if it's something that is needed at every page, at every website, in every case. And when we take a look at these items, like adding a link or an image or a video, is this something that should be done by the editor at every type of page? I don't think that's really the case. So why shouldn't we make sure that the toolbar of the rich text editor only allows you to use the options that you really need and make sure that you can focus on these items and won't try to fit in an image on a content area where you shouldn't use an image, for example. Here you see a content page at Rosette. It's one of the websites that we built. And at this page, you see there is room for a small intro and some links. And when you take a look at the doc type in Embraco, we help the editor by saying these are the only items that you can use, because they would fit in this area. And we don't want you to add other items, because they won't fit. And that's not why we build the front end this way, but that's not also why we want, that's not something that we want the visitors of the website want to see. Here you see that we use the item of format, and that's something that we use for styling, because we also build websites that are accessible and that are according to the official standards of accessibility. So we add styling on formats, and we don't add them separately. And here you see a content page at Dirkswager. And when you see the area where the author can put the body text, in the CMS we made sure that they have only these options, but we make sure that they can add an image or a link or a video. But all the other options we left behind because they don't need them. And in case of, and when they should need them, then we should think about, is it something that the editor should do, or is it something that the designer should take care of in the styling? Tip five, grid implementation. The grid can be amazing to work with, but it can also be hell. And it depends on how you implement it, but also on the level of the editor. And like I said, with a rich text editor toolbar, you can also think on the grid items that you should show in specific cases. Also default, you can say, I show every grid item that is made in every possible way that you could think of. In every row, with doesn't matter how many columns you want to use. But if you take a look at this, you can think of the situation where the editor tries to add a row with three columns. Should he use a banner in one of these three columns? Well, a banner is mostly used to show on a complete row with one column. In this case, you could think of why these items are shown for the editor in the three-column row. And why shouldn't you just make sure that all the items that could be used in this example, in a row with one column, why shouldn't we just only show the items that you should use in this case? And when there's a row with two columns, we show the other items or different items that he should use when a page is separate in two columns. In this case, you make sure that the editor won't have to think about if he should add a form in a row with three columns. Because when you think of the UX and the user experience for your platform, I don't think it's a good idea. Why wouldn't we make sure that the editor won't even have the options? And when you're adding these items for the grid, please make sure to use also icons and clear names. So if there's a long list of items that you could use in the grid, you should know what item has what function. And you can only do it by adding these icons and clear names. When we're talking about the grid, you can also think of the visualization of the grid. There are editors who won't need a lot of visualization because they know what the page is going to look like when they build it, and they know at what area of the page they want to adjust the content or the images. So you could give the grid in the CMS a wireframe look like this, and the editor should be fine if he's okay with it. But you can also make sure that the grid has more of a front-end look. So it makes it a lot easier to find the images that you want to adjust or see the text that you're going to manage. And when we're talking about content and settings, I think it's very good to think about what are settings that you really want to have adjusted by the editor. But also how often content is going to be managed. In this example, you see that we separated the content from the header and the settings, and we made sure that all the items that are mostly managed, mostly used, are placed at content. And we added the top header and made sure that some properties that are changed a little less often are placed on header. It's an extra click for the editor, but when he needs to use the content top most of the time, he doesn't have to click. So at content, we place everything that changes often. At header, we place the things that are a little less often changed. And at settings, we place the items that are maybe changed once a year or in a specific case, but not something that the editor should do daily. And I hear you think, well, this is Embraco 7, but here's Embraco 8. Well, I think there's still a tip 7 is still a tip when you're using Embraco 7. But when you use Embraco 8, I think you would or should use the accordions like you should use the tabs in Embraco 7 or previous versions. And in this way, you still can make sure that there are separate areas, and you really have to think about what items are mostly changed and managed by the editor, and make sure that they are very easy accessible. Remember James? This was what he looked like, and I think he's even more happy, but I don't think it's enough already. So, tip 8, relevant settings. We still see Embraco installations that are filled with settings that won't even are not going to be used, or that's something that the editor should not think about. And for example, the meta keywords. Search engines don't even use meta keywords anymore. So why should we ask the editor to add these keywords and think about them and fill this property and won't even use them? So don't do this anymore. Why not think about relevant settings per user? In this case, we made sure that the administrator of the CMS can think of the items that he wants to be placed at an overview page of products. And these filter items are based on product types, but there are also new products added by their collection. So these filter items can be changed by this administrator, but you don't want this to be changed by any editor. So what we did was made sure that this item where you can manage these filter properties is only seen by the administrator of the CMS. When I log in as just an ordinary editor, I won't even see this property. So I'm not even aware of the fact that we can manage it. But I also cannot break it. And I also cannot do something that wouldn't be done by me as just an ordinary editor. Tip 9, labels and descriptions. I also said it when I showed you the page of Dirkswager, the article page. When you build Umbreco and you make it specific for the website that you're building, there are a lot of items in the CMS that has a function. We're not very fond of making a document like in Word, for example, and adding a couple of documentations lines on how to use some sort of functions or how to use the CMS. Why shouldn't you just use the labels and descriptions to make sure that your Umbreco installation is the manual? And make sure that the information that you need when you use the CMS is there where you have questions or where you want to have some sort of extra explanation. So in all our installations, we use the labels and descriptions to make sure that the editor is given extra information where it's needed. And in some cases, these descriptions are very long, or we want to share more information than we could place at the descriptions. So we use this bigger text area to make sure that we still can use Umbreco as some sort of living manual. But there are also cases where we don't want to show something to the editor what he's going to miss. So in this case, we use the background color to make sure that the editor sees this item and sees this message and can use the information that we want to share with him. Tip 10, final tip. Maybe. Visualization of flows. When we build websites, there are there can be complex workflows. Let me give you this example of the law firm. They are not only sharing their knowledge online, they also organize seminars and workshops to make sure that their knowledge can also be shared offline. And as a visitor of the platform, I can sign up for these seminars. And when I do it, I can manage my registration in my personal account. And this is all on the platform that we built. And for example, I could cancel my registration because I'm not able to go to the seminar that I already registered for. And when I cancel, a lot of things happen. And that's not something that we can describe in the description, or place in the description, and make sure that every editor, every person that needs and uses the CMS will understand. But also for a developer or a designer or the project manager of the website, it's very good to have this workflow visual. So what we do with complex workflows is make them visual like this. And here you see that the cancellation of this registration can be started by the person who signed up in the first place. But it can also be cancelled by one of the employees of Dirkswager. And they do it in the CRM. And then a whole flow of steps is going to happen. And we want to make sure that everybody gets and everybody understands what is happening. So at complex workflows, we make them visual like this. And with it, we help the editor to make sure that he knows what happens after a specific action. But we also make sure that these flows are used as documentation. And when we want to use them as documentation, we place them in Umbreco. And we place them there where they are useful and helpful. In this case, we place them in the area that gives a lot of information on the seminars and on the events that we built in the platform. Workflows. Well, this was James. And this is James now. He's very relaxed. He really loves to use Embraco. He can chill behind his desk and he can think of great content, but there's still a little bit space for improvement. So here's a bonus tip. And maybe it isn't a bonus tip. Maybe it's an even the most important tip of this whole talk. And that is get to know your editor. Because you can adjust these 10 tips to your Embraco installation. But if you still don't know who's going to use it, who is this editor, what is his skills level and how many help does he need, then I don't think you can make the right choices for building this Embraco, this CMS for him. You have to make sure that you build a CMS that can be used by the editor and that he can only think of the great pages and the great website he wants to make. And don't let him think about the system. Don't let him get frustrated by the system and give him all the help that he needs to do his job. Build fantastic content. And to make sure that I want to show you two examples of make sure that you get to know the editor and build something that the editor really is going to use because he really needs it. And in this example, you see Wagenborg Passagiersdiensten, also known as WPD. And this company has a lot of ferries, and they bring over 1.5 million passengers every year to one of the two small islands in front of our coastline. They're not only transferring these persons, but also the cars. And they do this every day in all weather conditions. And when you want to join this ferry trip, you have to buy a ticket. And all the passengers buy their tickets online. So the website of WPD is their main asset. And they have a customer service that is available every day in the year for questions. But we don't want them to get overwhelmed by questions and don't even know where to find the answer or don't even know what visitor they are talking to. So we ask them, what do you need to make sure that if someone calls you or if someone sends you an email, that you know the answer to the question? We built them a specific dashboard where they have a lot of insights when it comes to the tickets and the transactions. Because most of the questions are about the transactions. Did I buy a ticket? Is it okay? What's the payment status? And we also make sure that the visitor can see this for himself on the website, in emails, but still people want to ask these questions and need to have this information or the confirmation that they did it right. So the customer service has this dashboard where they can see the payment status. This is name and account numbers, but also the amounts and the payment method. So when a visitor calls and asks something about his transaction, they have all the information they need to make sure they can answer the question. Let me give you another example. It's Ficurie. It's a hospital in the Netherlands. With Ficurie, we built a new website a couple of years ago. They had a goal, and they wanted to make the first accessible website officially for the hospitals. And they have a very broad target group, because everybody who needs healthcare can visit their website and can be looking for information. So when you want to build an accessible website, it's not only based on code or design, but it's also in the content. So you can make sure that your code and the design is according to the rules of accessibility. But the content that you edit every day also needs to have these standards. So we asked the marketing team how we could help them make sure that every content that they manage and add and maybe remove, and every page that's still standing, and that they're, according to the lines of accessibility. For the styling, I think we should do a little bit more. This dashboard is up and running for over 2 or 3 years now. And what we did at the dashboard is made sure that this marketing team that work with this website with the website every day has an overview of all the pages that are in the website and that are published. And we made sure that they know if the page is checked according to accessibility, but also if it's correct or maybe not yet correct. This helps them not only check once a year when they have to make sure the website is approved for accessibility, but they can do this every day and make sure that the website is all the time accessible. But we also made sure that they can see per specific page what's going on and give them an overview of everything that is correct on the page, but also what the elements are that they maybe need to adjust or the warnings that we could get out of the code when it comes to accessibility. And with these dashboards, we help them maintain their accessible websites for 3 years now. So this was James, 10 tips and a bonus tip ago. And I think we can say that with all these tips and with all these insights and with all the effort that you're putting in Embraco, we can make his life even more wonderful. And I know for sure that he will love you and Embraco if you think about the editor and make sure that the CMS does what he wants it to do. And that he can use it without frustration. Quick overview, what did we talk about today? Tip 1, login screen. Tip 2, the start screen. Tip 3, icons, colors, and descriptions. Tip 4, the rich text editor toolbar. Tip 5, grid implementation. And tip 6, the visualization of the grid. Tip 7, content versus settings. Tip 8, the relevant settings. Tip 9, labels and descriptions. And 10, visualization of flows. And my bonus tip, most important tip of the day, get to know your editor. Thank you.
Do we have any question for Fedosha?
Hi.
I'm
pretty new to Embraco, so like a lot of the things that you did backend, I have no idea where to start on that. So it's like, do you have put up a starter kit or anything like to help people get better at Embraco, or where would you start researching for doing crazy things like that?
Do you mean researching on how to get to know the editor, or
how to
apply these tips?
Yeah, how to apply them when you're programming.
Well, I think that a couple of tips are very easy to do and could also be done by a project manager like myself, the icons and the colors and the descriptions. That's something that I do as a project manager. And some of the items that should be done by a developer, because I can't code. So I asked the developer to think with me to make sure that the CMS is like very user-friendly for this editor. So together we think of the tips that we would like to apply.
Hello.
Hi.
Thank you for the talk. I especially liked your customized dashboards and welcome pages, and I can see several of my clients wanting that.
Yeah.
But also a problem getting them to pay for it, because the guy at my clients who manage the money is not usually the ones who are the editors.
Yeah.
How do you see that?
Well, you're trying to say that your clients don't want to pay for extra dashboards or extra.
I think it will be difficult to get the the ones who manage the money to pay for this.
Yeah. Well, we made it part of the things that we do. So when we build a website, we already know if the editor needs a dashboard and what needs to be on the dashboard. That's something that we do with the editor. But we think of the fact that there is a dashboard needed, and make sure that we build it in Umbraco the moment we start building it. So it's not something that we adjust later on or that we think of when the website is already live or launched or anything like that. So it's part of the deal. And that's how we do it. Because I think if we ask every client, would you like to pay extra for a dashboard? I don't think he says, yeah, I really want to pay extra. So part of the deal, I think it should be.
Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you.